بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله أما بعد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته my dear brothers in Islam and welcome back to the seer of Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. As we left you last time, that Quraysh had all the opportunities to negotiation. They even went to the Jews in Medina. They gave them the three proofs. They came back to Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. Tell us about these three things as we discussed in the last episode. Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم gave him all the proofs they want as revealed from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, in Surah Al-Kahf and so on about the young people that fled and about the righteous man of the Dhul-Qarnayn, the one that did the da'wah from the east to the west and about the ruh, the spirit. Even though gave him all the proofs they wanted, they still disobeyed. And they said, now that's it, it's time for the sword. There is no more talking. We'll let the sword do the talking. And we left you at the time with his uncle, Abu Talib, is now bringing Banu Abdul Manaf, Banu Hashim, and Abdul Muttalib to come in to aid Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. And they agreed, all of them, the believer and the disbeliever, except one man. I'll give you one guess. Could it be his own uncle? Abu Lahab? Allahu Akbar. Subhanallah. Only Abu Lahab actually did not go along with the both the tribes. Everyone except one man, Abu Lahab. Subhanallah. He did not go. He did not go along with them. But now they had to make sure that they stick together and they had to be on the same page. They agreed on what to do, what not to do. On the other side, however, they also had a plan. Unfortunately, they had all of the tribes except the other two tribes that we talked about came together and they agreed on certain things. Among the bands that they had in this treaty, oppressive however it is, it says we will not talk to those two tribes. We will not let them come into our homes. We will not go into their homes. We will not marry from them or them marry from us. We will not buy from them or sell to them. We will total boycott, nothing, absolutely nothing to do with them. Unless they give us Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam to be killed. Subhanallah. But if it wasn't to be, walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. The two tribes held their word, but they were ousted. They couldn't stay. Because they couldn't buy anything. They didn't give them anything to eat, nothing to drink. Total, not even buying and selling. The whole market, the whole business went down. Even the merchandise would come outside. The even Muslims would go out to try to buy it. Quraysh would pay more for it, for those dealers to come in and buy more. And except, you see Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu, what happens a little bit later. Subhanallah, ya akhi. Amazingly enough, he went to buy from his own, away from everyone. And the people comes up to him and says, we'll pay you more, we'll pay you more, we'll pay you more. He says, double the price, triple the price, whatever. He says, no, غيركم, somebody else paid me more. Who's more? Who was there? We're the businessmen in Quraysh. Who paid you more? Who do you think he had in mind? Allah subhanahu wa jalla fi ula. 10 times at least, up to 700 and more. So now what happened to them when they were ousted in Shu'bat Abi Talib? This Shu'bah is like a valley, a little bit of a place where they were actually taken out of their homes. This Sahifa, by the way, this book, the treaty, was written. It was mentioned as Ibn Ikrimah, according to Ibn Taymiyyah, rahmatullah alayh, or others, this is Nadr ibn al-Harith, as we mentioned, talked about him before, and he'll come back again, as you will see him, Satir al-Awwalin, later on. And really, it was somebody else. It was Baghid ibn Amir. Look at his name, Baghid. You know what the word Baghid means? Abhorred, disliked. Subhanallah, his name is Baghid. He's the one, the Sahih, in the most authentic narration, says it was Baghid ibn Amir, ibn Hisham. Allahu Akbar. He says he's the one that wrote the treaty. And Prophet Muhammad ﷺ learned about that, and he made a dua against him. Prophet Muhammad ﷺ did a dua, a supplication, and a prayer against this man. فَشُلَّتْ يَدَاهُ. The one that wrote the treaty, Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, as soon as he made the dua, his hand was paralyzed. Subhanallah. Amazing, ya akhi. And then this sahifa, this oppressive treaty with all these bands that we talked about before, it was actually placed in the Kaaba. to be put in a very secure place. No one would come close to it. Everybody witnessed it. They agreed upon it. And they put it in the Kaaba. Now, you can imagine, maybe 1 day, 2 days, 3 days, 1 month, 2 months, whatever, week, whatever. But it wasn't. It was for 3 years. They were boycotted for 3 years. Can you imagine yourself, akhi, boy, for 3 years, have nothing to be able to buy or drink and eat and no home, nothing out there. Again, I'm repeating this to remind you, just in case you think you're, you know, you have it hard and it's a tough life. I only have a house that's 5,000 square feet. Wow, man, that's a tough life. I'm looking for 15,000 or so on. Subhanallah. Anyway, for 3 years, this boycott was on. The Sahaba radiallahu anhu, he says, Wallahi, we didn't have anything to eat. You know what they used to eat? Awraq al-shajar. The leaves of the tree, akhi. They used to eat the leaves of the tree to stay alive. Just in case you're wondering if it's a famine or a drought or. One of them says, Wallahi, among the Sahaba radiallahu anhu, he says, Wallahi, I was walking one day till I felt something that was soft. When I was walking, I stepped on something soft. He says, I picked it up, cleaned it up, and I ate it. He says, Wallahi, la adri ma hiya hatta al-yawm. He says, by Allah, I don't know what I ate up till now. I don't know. It was something soft, I ate. That's all I did. Because otherwise, they were eating dry leaves. You can understand, akhi. Allahu musta'an, my brothers and sisters. How difficult they had it. But one of the righteous, I mean at least the good hearts among the disbelievers, was the nephew of Khadija radiallahu anhu arbaha. So he came up to her in secrecy, and he was trying to go in the darkness of the night to give some food for at least his aunt, Khadija radiallahu anha arbaha. And he took some food walking. Who met them? Who else? This lovely posse of Abu Jahl. Amazing. Abu Jahl, Abu Lahab, lovely people. Indeed, mwah, subhanallah, ya akhi. You say, la'natullahi alayhi, and you say, the subhanallah, how they are. He stood up and says, where are you going? He says, what are you talking about? I'm a free man. I can do whatever I want. He says, no. You know, I know where you're going, and you're taking this food to these people. We're not allowed to. He says, da'ni wa shi'ni. I'm among the honorable. You have no power over me. And they started fighting. A man came up to him. His name, Hisham Abu al-Bukhtari ibn Hisham. Abu al-Bukhtari ibn Hisham. He stood up to Abu Jahl. He was also among the honorable society. He says, what are you doing? Don't you know who this person is? He says, no, but he's breaking the covenant. We're not supposed to give him any food, and so on. He says, Wallahi, you have no power over him. Let him go. And they started to fight. Abu Hisham, al-Bukhtari ibn Hisham, what he did is actually started to fight with Abu Jahl for that young man to go to give the food to Khadija radiallahu anhu arbaha. Khadija, a very rich woman, she could have everything she want, but she chose to be next to her husband and with the tribe and this covenant. Allahu Akbar. So how are you doing, Ukhti? You standing next to your husband, inshallah? Or do you kick him when he's down? I'm sure not the sisters that are listening now, inshallah. These are good sisters, inshallah. They're supportive of their husband, I'm sure. Now, what happened? Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam learned about this. Al-Bukhtari ibn Hisham was fighting one day in a battle. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, do not touch Al-Bukhtari ibn Hisham. What is that, akhi? It's called wala, my brother. Wala. When people do good things to you or for you, do not forget it. And that is a proof, even though that he was not a Muslim, but Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam honored that, ya akhi. So you cannot tell me because he's not a Muslim, I can do whatever I want with him. I don't have to be good to them. I can steal from them. I don't have to be honest with them. Where do you come from? Where is this? Where is the proof in Islam, ya akhi? If Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam even had the wala, the loyalty to Hisham al-Bukhtari ibn Hisham, from his stand to Abu Jahl, once, he still do not touch him. He's off limit. And you will see what happens, inshallah, later on in the seerah when it comes to al-Bukhtari ibn Hisham. But Prophet Muhammad honored that, ya akhi. So we honor, we be good to people. Especially where, I mean, think about it. So when Prophet Muhammad is teaching us al-wala wal-bara, and I understand al-wala wal-bara is sometimes misunderstood. Since we're talking about it now, let's touch up on it quickly, inshallah. Now the sahifa, as we mentioned, it was totally oppressive. And the bans as such, And now when they started to feel a bit guilty about it, and even among the narration it says, Wallahi, I have not raised men. They were talking about whom? This woman, Atika, among the family of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And she says, have I not raised men? How could you? You're eating, it's a different tribe. You're eating and drinking, and وأخوالك, your uncles don't have any food and water. He says, what do I do? I'm only one man. And again, I know I talked about this before, but as soon as I hear I'm only one man, I have to remind you. Okay? This ummah started with one man. 1.5 and whatever it may be now, alhamdulillah, may Allah increase Muslims inshallah, true Muslims inshallah, in the ummah, started with one man. Don't tell me I'm one man, and you will see how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses one man to change things around. Believe it or not, they started to feel guilty about it. They started to talk about it. But no one wants to be the first one to say, you know what, let's break the covenant. It's been 3 years. It's really oppressive. Because sometimes, even though they agreed, they all agreed, except one man, Abu Lahab, alayhim Allah ma yastahiq, he's the only one that did not follow their own tribe and join them, and they all agreed that they're going to boycott them. They started to feel guilty, because in the beginning, you know, you're a bit of have an emotion. You know, you can make some mistakes when you're making decisions. But after a while, you know, you come back to your senses and you see this is wrong. Al-mu'min waqaf inda al-haq ya akhi. A true believer stops where the truth is about. When you have the proof, qala Allah, qala Rasul, you stop. Idha qila taqi Allah, akhadatul izza bil ithm. La ya akhi. Fahasbuhu jannam, riyadu billah. So if you say taqi Allah, fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, stop with the proof. Not that your pride gets in the way, as we talked about it before. So they started to say, okay, what do I do? I'm going to give you the list here, inshallah. He says that the first one is Hisham ibn Amr. He started to talk about it. He says, you know, wallahi, this is not fair. He started to feel a bit guilty. And he started to say, you know what, but I can't do it on my own. And he went to bin Bani Amr ibn Lu'ay. He says, Ummu Atika bin Abd al-Muttalib, she says that, you know, as I mentioned earlier, haven't raised men. How could you be eating and drinking when your uncles are actually not eating and drinking? And as you mentioned again, I'm only one man and I need some more. So he started to go to look for some more allies. So we learned something, that united, as you will see, even though there weren't too many men, but the united front makes a major difference, as you will see the lesson learned from that, inshallah. So he went to Zuhair ibn Umayyah al-Makhzumi. He went to him and says, you know, how do you feel about this? He says, wallahi, I don't feel very good about it. I don't think it's fair. 3 years is a long time. They're still from our family and friends. He says, we need some more. So he says, we want to go to al-Mut'am Na'di. Remember the name that I mentioned, the Prophet Muhammad actually used him, as you will see, he will use him later on. When, you know, after Aam al-Huzmin, he goes to Ta'if and he goes back, Anta fi Jawari. There are some people, they had a good heart. They still felt something. They were good. They were, some of them had some emotions, at least, as a human being. And they went to Mut'a ibn Abri. فَذَكَّرُوا بِأَرْحَامِهِ, meaning that they remember, you know, these are from the, still from the family, whether they're far away or nearby, they're still family. We cannot just cut them off. So he actually got on board. And they went to whom? They added some more. They said, we need to go to Al-Hisham, again, Abu-l-Bukhtari ibn Hisham, the one that we mentioned earlier. They said to him, and as you know, that he defended, again, for Khadija, and he stood up for Abu Jahl. Abu Jahl now is their enemy now. Okay, he's the one that they have to make sure that he doesn't, because he's the one that was loud, Jahur. He's the one that is making sure that no one breaks his covenant, and he's among them, he was the leader, apparently, inshallah. Allahu a'lam, there were too many leaders in that issue, inshallah. And then they went to another man. They said, we need another man. So they went to Zum'ah ibn al-Aswad ibn al-Muttalib. Again, they reminded him of the lineage, and they reminded him of the kinship and so on, and they got on board. So he says, now, what do we do? He says, we have to put a plan. And we have to put a plan. What is it? He says, we will come up one at a time. One of us starts. And I'm sure what they do is they expected what's coming up. Obviously, Abu Jahl will stand up. And some, you know, resistance. So when somebody stands up, he will come and deny this fact and say, no, you cannot break it. And everybody else is with me. So it's a tug of war. After one of us stands, the other person stands, but not all together. We cannot stand all together. And the other one stands and he says the same thing. And what happens is that he will see Abu Jahl is defending it, and another person comes up, that he will think there were too many of us, and Abu Jahl will not be able to stand in front of us all. And that's the plan they had. The following day, when they gathered the people, one of them stood up. They said, you know, this covenant that we have, the sahifa, this paper that we have, the treaty, is not really fair. How could we be eating and drinking in our own homes and our own, some of our families out there not eating and drinking? Out there there's no food and water for 3 years. Enough is enough. Let's break the covenant. Let's break this treaty. It's an unfair, oppressive treaty. Who stands up as planned? Abu Jahl, of course. Who else? He says, La wallahi la tunqadh. Nay, by Allah, we cannot break it. We already made the covenant. Everybody signed. Everybody agreed. We were all there. Then that second man comes up. And he says, Bel tunqad. Tunqad. I had the an accent there from a place where I used to live, but it's bad, inshallah, not bad. So you say, Wala dalin, inshallah, wala dalin. I'm glad I shared that story with you. Moving on, inshallah. What happened is, a second man stood up and says, No, tunqad. Of course it will be breaking. We have to break it. And then Abu Jahl again, he says, What's going on? You're in stereo. One, I just made one man silent. The other man comes up. What's going on? So the second man comes up. He says, No, we have to break this treaty. He says, No, we cannot break this treaty. The third man stands up. And all of these are among the Arab society. And the third man stood up. He says, No, tunqad. It will be broken. And the third and the fourth and the fifth, and they went on and they went on, and he couldn't. It was only one man trying to defend or fend off all these among the Arab society, and the majority were silent. They didn't know what to do. We learn a lesson here, that the silent majority have no weight. No weight, wallahi. So remember the hadith of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that the come time will come, da'a alaykum umam. The umam will come and eat. It's like this qas'ah, you know, this big pot where everybody eats from. The umam, nations will come and do that to us. Then the sahaba radiallahu anhu majma'een said, أو من قلة نحن يا رسول الله. Is it because we're a few in numbers? He says, بل أنتم كثير. No, but you're too many. Abundance. It's not the numbers. لكنكم كغثاء السيل. You know, one narration of the interpretation of this hadith, it says that, you know, those bubbles on the top of the wave in the oceans, nothing. Just it breaks up and it's like a nothing in the wind goes. Other interpretation, it says that when the rain falls, you know those light ashes and everything that there's nothing, no weight onto it, is carried by this water, no weight. So if you feel like a nail in a big wheel going, you have no control of yourself, akhi, or what's going on, ummah, hang in there, inshallah. But we have to come back. And the story was, and it says, why? He says, why? How could that be? He says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take the fear of the heart of your enemies and put in your hearts wahan. So they asked him, what is this wahan? It's hubbu dunya wa karahiyat al-maut. His love of this dunya and despising or disliking death. Subhanallah, ya akhi. Did we actually come to this point, my brothers and sisters? I remember this righteous scholar at the time of the meeting, he says, khudni ila al-amar. Take me to the inhabited area. You know what he took him? He took him to the cemetery. He says, what are you doing? I asked you to take me to the Amar. You take me to the cemetery? He said, I asked you to take me to the areas where they dwell in, the inhabited area. He says, yes, I know. He says, كل من هناك يأتي إلى هنا ولا أحد من هنا يرجع إلى هناك. فأين العمار? He says, everyone out there will come here, and none of them here will go back to there. So where is the true dwelling? Where is the true life? So this strife that Prophet Muhammad has taken says that we love this life and we forget the hereafter. So we invest everything here. Have you invested anything in the hereafter, akhi and ukhti? You want to build this house? How about the castle waiting for you in Jannah? Brick of silver, brick of gold. What happened to us, akhi and ukhti? So by the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the majority of the honorable society were agreed, and the silent majority means nothing, as you know now. So when you hear something, write a letter, make a phone call, send an email, stand up for what's right, akhi and ukhti. Stand up for what's right, and do it legally and lawfully, inshallah, not the other way around. So with that, we will know that the sahifa was on the way, this covenant was on the way out, to be broken. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, the good news was being spread, and now they said, no. Prophet ﷺ said, one narration said, I have seen a message, and this message will have to wait till the next episode. After this, inshallah, asking Allah to make us among those who listen to speech and follow the best of it. وآخر دعوة الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على آله وصحبه وتابعين جزاكم الله خيرا والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.